before Snake Dance. I don't like this one. I find it shit. Possibly worse than Kinder, although I have given Kinder a lower score, so maybe that's not the case. There's better stories to come, and it feels like we're in a bit of a bad story streak with Time Flight, which I did find enjoyable, but it was bad. And Arc of Infinity, which was an improvement on story, but was still bad. And then there's Snake Dance, which, oh god. And I thought Kinder was bad, which it is. But, you know, maybe a rewatch might change my mind. So let's just get this one out of the way. After. Okay, I don't find this story shit anymore. I actually kind of like it. I actually found myself enjoying quite a bit of it. I think it does go down halfway through the middle, but it's still a pretty good story. I mean, it's not as good as Earthshock or Visitation or Black Orchid, but still pretty good. I mean, one of the strongest stories of the Fifth Doctor's era so far. So, yeah, maybe I was too harsh on this story previously. So, Snake Dance. Hello ladies and gentlemen, Nick here, and welcome to my review of Snake Dance, the second story of Doctor Who Season 20, and the sequel to Kinder. And also, this season is seeing multiple recurring villains, as I think I did mention. So we had Omega in the last story, we've got the Mara back this time round, and the next three stories are going to form a trilogy featuring the return of the Black Guardian. And we've got the Master in the final story, and of course they were supposed to have Resurrection of the Daleks at the very end. But due to fucking strike action, it was delayed to season 21. And changed a little bit out to also be Tegan's departure story. So that would have featured the return of the Daleks and maybe even Davros. If he was going to feature in the original version. At least we've got the Five Doctors at the end. That's good. We've still got the Five Doctors, which is pretty much the Day of the Doctor of the classic series. With all the references and fangasms. Basically, with Daleks, Cybermen, the Master, Yeti even make an appearance at one point. Well, a Dalek, a Yeti, two factions of Cybermen with their own cyber leaders, both played by David Banks, and of course the Master back. And yeah, it's one story after the last Master story, but he's done that before. Look at season 8 and the New Beginnings trilogy, and he will cameo in Caves of Androzani right after Planet of Fire. So and of course, all of the Missy appearances in series 8 and 10, not 9, because she appeared in two episodes of that one, and they were the same story. Anyway, Snake Dance. I actually didn't like this story before rewatching this one for the review. I found it terrible. I found it boring, uninteresting, and unlikable. Kinder also fell into that same trap over time, except that whilst that one's gone way down in opinion, so with the latest rewatch of Kinder eventually making me go on a rant about it, in a way, two rants, because I had to do the reaction and supplement for the review, and then managed to get the review out. Reactions of all channels have been deleted now. The ones that supplement for the reviews, that is the normal reactions. There's like my reaction to the new Bond title, for example, that they can stay up. It's their normal reactions, but for the supplement ones, they're gone. Anyway, so. But yeah, I ended up ranting about Kinder. I hated that story. I really fucking hated it. Not as much as Warrior's Gate, which is another story I ranted about not too long ago. But still certainly, definitely the worst Fifth Doctor story, possibly for me. Might stay that way, depending on how the other stories of the seasons 20 and 21 turn out. And Snake Dance, I actually expected to hate it even more, because I previously hated it even more, even though it still had a high score beforehand. But actually, I enjoyed it, mostly. I mean, there's some weak bits, but yeah, and the Doctor trying to get people to, trying to convince people about something and running around and people not believing him. We have done that before. Macroterror is a good example. That came out not too long ago. That's why I keep referencing it. Might be a new series one as well. But I think, yeah, you know, but this time around, I think it's okay. I actually see why they did that. Although having the Doctor and then later Nyssa as well locked in the cell for an episode or most of an episode is time wasting. I mean, we do learn some good backstory about the history base, but it's still, they could have done that on the move or in a better location. And similarly, they do kind of intercut scenes where the Doctor and Nyssa are trying to help Tegan with the Mara out, but they're also going back and forth between that and the scenes with the history. And I'm more interested in the Tegan stuff. The history stuff I would be more interested in if they were all put together as their own separate scenes. Another thing that I think was bad editing is that we had a shot of this guy, I can't remember his name, but he's a previous guy in charge of the case. He's gone to join the Snake Dancers because he had the theory that Mara would be back. We open on shots of him and we keep cutting to getting closer, and then we cut inside the TARDIS. Why don't we just cut inside the TARDIS straight away? We just, at times, we just randomly cut to this guy for a few seconds, cut back. We don't have to see him before they go and look for him in part four. We could have just seen him for the first time in part four. It felt like they were putting this in for no reason. Or maybe if he did something a bit more active than just sitting there, then maybe, or maybe if he there was a point where he realized there were people looking for him or something to justify him making appearances before the Doctor, Nyssa, and this other guy that they accompany go looking for him, or a shot where after a character's talked about him, we get to see who they're talking about. But just seeing him as the first character on screen isn't necessary. What's even worse is that you could have filled this time with that with the final scene. There's a scene that's cut from this story, a deleted scene that appears on the DVD. It's registered as deleted scenes from the original ending of part four. It's just one scene, mostly. I mean, there's a few bits that parts of the scene they did include have been jiggled about in the final edit, and some bits have been reduced, have been chopped off. But then there was a final scene that pretty much clears up some information and clears up some things people might actually be confused about. So, and actually feels like more of a typical ending to a Doctor Who story than what we got, with a pretty good final shot. Although the ending we did get was good, I think that final ending would have been even better, at least with the explanation and the final shot in line. Even if it's very stereotypical Doctor Who ending, which I will say for the original end, the ending we do have is that it is a bit different. But I think having the original ending would have been good as well. But yeah, but point is, I think we should have opened in the TARDIS, cut some of those bits with what's his face, the guy with the snake dances thing, until we actually get to meet him in part four, as opposed to seeing him several times for no reason, unless a character's talking about him and we get to see who they're talking about. And then we could have time for that original ending. So, yeah, that would have been a good idea. But there are some pretty good things about this story. I do like the visual effect that has the snake skeleton talking in a way when it's just, yeah, I don't know how they did that, but it looks good, and it's probably one of the better effects of this story. There are some dodgy effects here. Yeah, it's the 1980s, but they could have tried a bit more. But that one in particular is really good. And also, the snake actually looks a bit more like a snake as opposed to a hokey visual effect like in Kinder. Some good acting. Martin Clunes gives off mixed signals as a guest character, but he's really good in the evil stuff when he's being evil. Same for Janet Fielding, and once again doing a fantastic performance as the Mara possessed Tegan, and she was definitely the highlight of Kinder, along with the imagination scenes, the scenes in the mind. That was good, and we kind of get hinted at this here, but it's more focused on the Mara taking over her mind, on the fight of it taking over her mind, whilst this time round it's that Damara has won and the Doctor needs to fight it off and needs to get rid of it. And yeah, it's got some good stuff. Six Faces of Delusion scene is also pretty interesting, where the Doctor explains that the Six Faces of Delusion does include the wearers. It's kind of like a hat, although the guy shouts at him to get out right after this. The Doctor didn't really offend him there, so I don't know what his problem is. It's just like, he's just been proven wrong about something, so he's angry. Fuck you. Okay, and also, like I said, I think it's a bit of dodgy editing where we keep cutting back and forth between TARDIS and history stuff. I think we could just could have had some TARDIS stuff, bigger chunks of TARDIS stuff. Then maybe we could have seen what was happening on the planet, and then maybe cut and forth every now and again as opposed to every other couple minutes in part one. But there's still some enjoyable stuff. It does kind of slow down and get less interesting in parts two and part three, even more so because with the Doctor in the cage, it's just boring. And the guy doesn't even need him in the cage. If he doesn't think he's a threat, then he doesn't need him around. Just let him go. I don't know. This is just weird. But some decent stuff, some enjoyable stuff. And the final episode is quite fun for the most part. Some pretty good stuff. And so it's all right. I mean, it's not a bad story. I don't know what it was that I disliked last time. Maybe I just didn't like the whole, they didn't believe the Doctor and just fucking around at the moment. And yeah, some of the characters aren't that great. But a whole lot better than Kinder. They weren't not doing something they were supposed to be doing. Like, with the whole, in Kinder, it's the whole psychological dream sequence thing. That was really great, and people have even tried to write books about how that influence on psychology. Take it as an example of that. And whilst there is, they have a point, it does feel like they've paid too much attention on the young soldier going insane, but not in a gradual way. And that kind of annoyed me, plus the fact that the Kinder stuff was also not that interesting. Here we actually have good historical backstory, and the psychological stuff is focused on where it needs to be focused on. So Snakedance actually is more solid when it comes to the foundations of its story. Not to mention the story itself is actually better than Kinder. It's actually a good story, and some decent characters. I mean, yeah, and good acting for the most part. And also, I like how Nyssa is getting a bit more involved in this story. Although I do have to say, after Adric died, whilst Nyssa has become a bit more of a stronger companion, who's a bit more tough in some certain circumstances, she's also gotten a bit more screamy. Once a story since Time Flight, she's been screaming at least one scene. But I don't see Nyssa as that type of character. I mean, yeah, maybe. Yeah, she's scared or something. She has a fright or something. But literally every single, the three stories since Earthshock, she has screamed at least once. Yet I don't see Nyssa in that role. Then again, I wouldn't have thought Sarah Jane to be in that role, and she's screamed a few times. I mean, not as much as Joe or as Victoria or Susan or someone, or Mel later down the line. Maybe not even Perry, but still, I wouldn't have expected it from Nyssa. Not really. In fact, I think Perry screams less. It screams less. Don't hold me to that. I'll find out for certain when we get to Mind Warp. But yeah, so Nyssa's getting a bit more scared in some of these stories, as well as also getting a bit tougher. It's kind of like a double-edged sword. I will say she does get a lot more things to do, and that is a great thing, as Nyssa is my favourite of the season 19 trio of companions. And she will be departing in two stories' time, so it's good to see her having a bit more of a developed character growth and get a bit more involvement, whilst also in a very Tegan-centred story. In fact, this one sort of allows Tegan to be the villain in a way, although under Mara influence, and actually gets a bit more time to shine. Kinder did allow a bit of Tegan shining, and like I said, that was the highlight of that story, but it also focused a lot with the Doctor and Adric, with the humans and with the Kinders, and it just It was a bit of a mess when it came to focusing on characters, and this was a way in the TARDIS at the moment because they had to make an excuse for her not to be in that story because they didn't have her in that story originally, so they had to quickly write an excuse in. Yeah, and thankfully we don't have that. We've only got the two companions here. And, you know, for the most part, I think Snakedance is a good story. I think it's okay. I think it's effective. Not perfect. I think it's okay. Think it's good. I'm not going to love it as much as Earthshock. I wouldn't even like it as much as Visitation. But you know what? I'm happy that I like this story. After all the other times I hated it or disliked it, I actually like it on a rewatch. So, yeah. Some enjoyable start parts, mostly at the start, the first half of part one, and some other good stuff thrown throughout the story, mainly in parts one and four. Parts two and three kind of drag a little bit, but there's some good stuff throughout both of them, especially that scene with Amara and Tegan talking with each other in the Hall of Mirrors. Very good effect or animation or whatever they did for the snake head talking. That was very good. And Janet Fielding's always brilliant at playing evil Mara. So I'm going to be giving Snakedance a 7 out of 10. You know, after this story, I wouldn't have minded seeing the Mara one more time, making a trilogy. In a way, even though this story does pretty much is a finale story for the Mara, it pretty much states that. But then again, in Ark Infinity, it's the same for Omega, yet still potential for him to come back. Look at the Big Finish audio. He was originally going to come back in Canine Timequake, probably other expanded media stories. He could still even return in a new series story at some point, maybe. So, yeah, whilst the Mara seems to be destroyed here, the door's still left open. In fact, Big Finish have had at least one Mara story. And also, I think they might be adapting or might have adapted another Mara story. That was going to be written by Chris Bailey for a third Mara story because they were impressed by the other two. Definitely with Snakedance, I would have seen it right. Not sure Kinder, but some people like it for some reason. I don't know. Yeah, but I wouldn't have minded another Mara story after rewatching the story. Before rewatching the story, I was thinking, if I hate it again on the rewatch, then I would be saying that I'm glad there wouldn't be another Mara story. Because if it's going to be like the first two stories, then yeah, I'm glad they didn't get around to doing a third one. But now that I like Snakedance, then actually I would have been up for a third one. See how that went. And yeah. Maybe Kinder fans would have wanted a third one. I'm not sure. I don't know if Kinder fans are Snakedance fans as well or not. You know, Snakedance, actually pretty good. I actually kind of like it. Yeah, and that's after a couple of days of me saying it's terrible and I'm not looking forward to it. I even had to reshoot and edit in a new ending to the Ark of Infinity review to say such a thing. And put the original review in the bloopers. So you can check that out if you want. So anyway, that's Snakedance. I think it's good. So that's it from Snakedance. Actually, surprisingly good. Mostly. I mean, some problems with it, but not enough for me to go on a rant about it like I thought I was going to do. Anyway, next time should be another story which I think is good. I mean, I did last time I watched it. So hopefully, fingers crossed, it will stay that way. And that's Mordred Undead. So hopefully this will still be a good story. But you never know. Snakedance went up, so maybe this one might go down. Pray to God it doesn't. Best to go up than to go down, if you know what I mean. But anyway, next time, Mordred Undead, which features the return of the Brigadier and the introduction of Turlo and the return of the Black Guardian. Played by the same actor, by the way. So that's cool. The same actor who was in Armageddon Factor. Okay, so I'll see you guys next time. Goodbye. 't forget to click below to subscribe to the official Nicholas Payne Retro YouTube channel. Before. After. After. Okay, I don't find this story any shit anymore. Which, right after the previous story, that does make sense because the Master has done that before. And the last few, last, and the new beginnings. So with the last review, sorry, the latest rewatch, ending up being although I do have to say, as soon as Adric has died, not only has Nyssa become more of a independent, although I do have to say, whilst, if these two stories are the way they're going to be dealt with, because if these are the two stories, they're going to, he's still even returning, even had to re-edit and reshoot the Ark Infinity reviews. So, yeah, did I say about 10? I think so. If I didn't, then... So I'm going to give Snakedance a 7 out of 10. Okay, and then we'll cut to the reason why. I'll take that bounce downstairs.